This is your world, so let's vow to make it a better place. Let every heart that needs to know your love is here to stay. Oh, it's time we live a new life. Oh, let us love shine bright in you. We're saved by His grace, so we embrace your love today. We are changed.
There are things that that's happened in my life. I wonder, why is it taking so long? When is this gonna move? When is this pain gonna stop? When is this gonna go away? And I had to catch myself. I'm like, now you can't keep doing this every day. You get up every day talking about win. Then heaven gonna start saying all you do is win. There's got to be a point like Paul. Paul said, I went to God 3 times about this thorn in my flesh. Yeah. And he said, God kept saying to him, my grace is sufficient. My grace is enough. And Paul finally got it. When I'm weak, that's when I'm strong. What was he doing? He was responding now to the trial and the temptations the right way. And we got to do the same thing. So I don't know. You know, when God says, this will be in a little while, I don't know how long a little while is. A little while can be months, it can be years, but something happens with a person who maintains his stance in the victory that Jesus has already given him. And no matter how long it lasts, you're gonna come out more mature, more entire, and wanting nothing. So maybe God's trying to mature you in this thing that you're wondering when it's gonna be over. Who are you to counsel God? God knows what's down the street, behind the building, around the corner, that's eventually going to be in your life, and you don't know. And He knows the level of maturity. He knows exactly where you need to be in order to walk this thing out successfully. He knows the battles that are ahead of you, praise God. Jesus went and was tempted for 40 days and for 40 nights, getting prepared for the battle that's ahead. Then went to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he sweat blood, getting ready for the battle ahead. No cross, no crown. And I think a lot of people, we want the crown with no cross. And that's not how it happens. And so no matter how long it takes, I'm going to allow patience to have a perfect work, so when I come out of it, I'm going to be mature, I'm going to be entire, and I'm not going to want nothing, which means whatever was wrong, it ain't going to be wrong no more, because I ain't going to want nothing, because if I come out and I'm still wanting what I wanted in the first place, then, you know, that's not what he's saying. Maturity, entire, completeness, wanting nothing. Don't delay your maturity because you're afraid of this thing not leaving so quickly. I'm standing on God's promises. With long life will He satisfy me and show me great salvation. I believe that now. I believe that when the pain comes. I believe that when the pain is over with, let patience have her perfect work. What is it that you believe? Don't wait till the trouble come to believe it. It's what you believe right now. It's what you believe right now. I'm delivered right now. I'm delivered in the middle of the temptation. I'm delivered after the temptation. And then you'll say, like I said. This is a practical way of dealing with those things that may be involved in our lives to strengthen us and to mature us for what God has called us to do. We must mature. Now, temptation is pressure applied to your flesh, and I'm going to take it a little deeper this morning. It is pressure applied to your way of thinking. Pressure applied to your way of thinking. Satan operates in the mind. The mind is the battleground. So he's going to attack your way of thinking. And if you're believing what you're believing, he's going to do everything he can to try to put pressure on what you're believing on. That's what temptation is. Pressure applied to the flesh or pressure applied to your way of thinking. You can receive promotion if you let patience in pressure have its perfect work. You can receive healing if you let patience in pressure have its perfect work. Just don't give up, cave in, and quit. There's a lot of people quitting these days. A lot of people quitting these days. You're not one of them. You're going to be an example of what happens if you don't give up, if you don't cave in, and if you don't quit. We don't have quitters in this house. Somebody says, how you know? I'm declaring my faith right now. Ain't no world changers. World changers don't quit. We don't give up. We don't cave in. We don't quit. We fight the good fight of faith. What is the good fight of faith? We maintain our posture of victory. We maintain the victory that Jesus died to obtain. He obtained the victory, gave it to us. Our job is to maintain the victory. Our job is not to fight to try to get the victory. That's Jesus' job. He fought, he got the victory. That's a settled issue. We maintain the victory. So when the devil comes and he tries to hit you with sickness and you say, no, by his stripes, I'm healed. I don't care what the doctor say. No, by his stripes, I'm healed. I don't care what the doctor say. You maintain your victory. You maintain your stance. You do it. You do it. Well, Brother Dada, what if they die maintaining? What a way to go. Amen. Now, look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10 through 12 in the NLT. Today, I want to really set this up by really showing you the scriptures on these things. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 through 12 in the NLT. I believe that pressure is a required course for the believer. I never thought that before. I came up where most of the time they say, I tell you what, if you're going through something, you're doing something wrong. Or if that thing happened to you, it's because you didn't have enough faith. I don't believe that. I used to. But now I look at situations and I look at people and I'm like, whoa, they really going through. And I'm like, boy, God must be getting ready to do something serious with them. Ooh, that must be a devil-kicking anointing getting ready to show up in their life. And then what do? We start praying and start encouraging that person. And, Lord, is there anything you want me to do to help them out at that particular time? But I no longer look at them like they did the boy who was born blind. Did they sin that this thing happened to them? No. There are lots of things that show up in your life. It showed up in Jesus' life. Are you kidding? And look at the Apostle Paul. It seemed like Paul couldn't go nowhere without trouble. You understand what I'm saying? Paul get on the boat wreck. You know? And I think they're sitting around on the beach trying to fry some fish, you know? And a snake bit him. And then he was preaching and they threw him off a cliff on some rocks. Dang. Paul talked about it. Now, we'll see it in a minute. All the persecution he had. And as Christian people, in a time where God's getting ready to use the body like never before, we can't be afraid of trouble. Amen. Look at this, verse 10. He says, but you, Timothy, certainly know what I teach, and you know how I live, and you know what my purpose is in life. You know my faith, Timothy, you know my patience, you know my love, you know my endurance. You know how much persecution and suffering I have endured. You know all about how I was persecuted in Antioch and Iconium and Lystra. But the Lord rescued me from all of it. I got good news for you. I don't know what tribulation you went through, what persecution you're going through, what city that you give, no matter what it is, but the Lord will deliver you from them all. He'll deliver you from the sickness. He'll deliver you from the debt. He'll deliver you from the slander. He'll deliver you from whatever you need delivered from. God will deliver you from it all. And when it gets rough in the middle of pressure, it might not be a bad idea for you to just go ahead and preach to the devil. Hey, devil, God will deliver me. And devil say, no, he won't, and turn it up a notch. And you're like, God will deliver me. He delivered three Hebrew boys out of the fiery furnace. He delivered Daniel out of a lion's den. Hallelujah. He delivered Jesus out of the pit of hell, sat him down on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and he will deliver me. God will deliver us. I'm testifying here. God will deliver you. God will deliver you. You got to know there's no way I can be called to preach grace and not at least go through at least a third or a half of what Paul went through. I'm just not the kind that get up and complain on the pulpit all the time. I don't like telling testimonies until it's finished. Because as far as I'm concerned, it is finished. But I want to be manifested for the whale butt cry. Turn to your neighbor and say, God will deliver you from anything you go through. I believe that. I believe that. I don't know what y'all going through today. I don't know what you went through this past week. I don't know what's waiting on you this upcoming week, but I do know we have a mighty deliverer. Verse 12 says, yes, and everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. Yeah. It took me some years to get that because I could say, yeah, but if you did this and if you did that and if you say your confessions every day and if you and you know, if you take communion all the time, if you don't miss the time at church and if you do all of these things, then you ought not suffer persecution. And I realized I did all of them. And persecution just wouldn't leave. Persecution just kept showing up. I'd be home praying, and persecution to show up. I mean, talking in serious tone. Yeah, kala da ba, going on a whole hour. And then I realized, okay, just because trouble comes, doesn't mean it has to overcome. What happens now? Now you're talking like a mature person. Immaturity whines at trouble. And I don't know why I'm always having to get there. Why is everybody always picking at me? I ain't did nothing to nobody. I'm trying to live right. No, if you're gonna live godly, you're gonna see some persecution. But we got to handle it right. We can't sit there and let it handle us. We got to handle it right. We're Christian people. And then put on the best face you can. Wash your face. Dress yourself up. Don't go around looking pitiful like you're trying to get somebody to ask you what's wrong. You took a bath all week. Somebody go ask you what's wrong. Hey, what's wrong? No, don't seek. Ask the Lord to help you not to walk in self-pity.
They know ain't nobody call me. Here I am sick. Ain't nobody call me. Ain't nobody visit me.
Then you start scratching friends off your friends.
Well, they ain't friend no more. I ain't heard from them.
Like they're supposed to know what's going on with you. And my wife say, be nice to your children if you want somebody to take care of you when you get old. I'm being real nice to my kids now, boy. Amen. Now, let's go to Luke 22, 42, NLT. Luke 22, 42. Dog, I feel like I'm in class this morning instead of church. I wouldn't serve a God I couldn't feel every now and then. Yeah. Luke 22, 42. Look at Jesus now. He's in the Garden of Gethsemane. He's getting ready to go through literal hell. I mean, he's going to the place, literally going through it. He said, Father, if you are willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. I could not even think about, I couldn't fathom what he knew he had to go through. I mean, he literally had to go to hell. I couldn't. Lord, if you're willing, please take this cup of suffering away from me. We've all prayed that prayer. Lord, take this pain from me. Lord, fix this brokenness in my life. Lord, this relationship, take it, just take it. Take it, take it. But he did something that was so awesome. He demonstrated real maturity. Yet, I want your will to be done, not mine. Not mine. Boy, I had to really get a hold of that. Not mine. Oh, God, let everybody like me. Oh, God, let every job situation favor me. Oh, God, let me never have bills to pay. Yeah, I like that one, huh? Yeah. But what about, you know, let your will be done. Maybe you see that I need this course. Maybe it's something about my future that I can't see that you know about. And you know I need to go through this so I can be ready for that. When we were in Bible school some years back, some of you remember I taught on the wide line. That in ministry, the line is not just straight, but it's a wide line. And the reason why we call it a wide line is because maybe God will have you to go through here so you'll be prepared for here. And then maybe he'll have you to go over here so you can be prepared for over here. But you're still making progress. Maybe he'll have you go here so you'll be ready for what's here. Maybe he'll have you here so you can be ready for what's here. And then if you turn around and look back, you've gone through a whole preparation for here. So we don't need to despise the stuff that we have to go through. And Jesus said, your will. That's what we need to start praying. Not mine. Because if it was left up to me, I would never have anything to attack my body. I would never have to endure worldwide persecution. Never, none of that. But that may not be his will. And I know from 41 years in ministry, the stuff that I've gone through prepared me to teach this curriculum of grace. Had I not gone through it, the stuff that happened would have just freaked me out. What is God preparing you for? And stop praying your will. Start asking God, let your will be done. Can your will be done? And that's what I want. And that's been my prayer. What's your will, God? What do you want me to do? If something I started up is not your will, don't let anything happen. Close every door. Close every door. Maybe God put the desire in your heart to do something. Step out on it. If it's not, it won't work. Ain't nothing gonna happen anyway. You'll know it after a while. Some people be trying to just not. It's like, dude, you started a church 20 years ago with 3 people. You got 2 now. Safe to say that's not God's will for your life. Right? But when you pray, let God will be done, then going up that wide line, Lord, let your will be done. Well, God don't make nobody sick. True. Well, how come I went through that? He allows certain things to happen if it's going to perfect you. You look in the Bible, there's a whole lot of things that God didn't send that he allowed for growth, for development, pressure to mature you. And we've got to grow up as a church. The church is too immature and is holding up things that God wants to do that he needs maturity in order to do it through. Signs and wonders and miracles, you need mature people, because immature people, after a while, if I start using them with signs and miracles, they'll think it's them. So I'm not talking about having no doctrinal argument about whether the trouble or the sickness or something came from God. All I know, and I've been through this 41 years now, I've been through this, and I know that had those different things had not happened, it would not have brought me to a place of maturity where I am right now. Because I'm at this place right now, really, it's really tough for you to do anything. It don't bother me no more. I just, whatever. I realize people gonna do what they wanna do. Praise the Lord. My job is to plant and to water. God's job is to increase. I can't want it more than somebody else want it. I just believe the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Folk gonna do, I learned this during the whole pandemic thing. Folk do what folk won't do. So I sit you down, I give you advice, and I'm done. You heard me the first time. You just already made your mind up, I'm gonna do what I wanna do. Ain't no use for me wasting my time. On Sunday, can I see Pastor? No, I just finished preaching. Well, I gotta ask him something. That's why you need a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. You need to depend on Jesus, not me.